Фарисеям послание святаго апостола Павла чтение. Братие, мою ви аз, юзник о Господе, достойно ходите звания, неже звани бесте, со всяким смиренным мудрием и кротостью, с долготерпением, терпящий друг друга любовью, чашица пусти единение духа, союзе мира, едино тело, един дух, яко же и звани бесте, по едином упование звания вашего, един Господь, едина вера, едино крещение, един Бог и Отец всех, и жена всеми, и чрез всех, и во всех нас.
I was born and raised in Glasgow, in Scotland, which was part of the United Kingdom. And our country is predominantly Protestant, with a lot of Catholics, although we're extremely secular, and in fact very, very few people actually go to church. So I was raised in what was a Protestant family, but we stopped going to church when I was very, very young. So I don't really have any memories of going to church, apart from when it was Easter and Christmas with school. That was it, the only time I remember going. So I had no religious upbringing, although from a young age I was interested in different religions and reading about them, histories and things like that, but never practicing anything. And when I was a teenager, actually from even before I was a teenager, I got into rock music and eventually punk. I was very involved in hardcore punk music with my friends, and at the same time as I was a teenager, I was also very active in the Scottish Socialist Party. I was a communist pretty much, because I read the literature and I liked the ideas of it. And I was a youth activist in the Scottish Socialist Youth, which was basically the Scottish equivalent to the Komsomol. So I would just put posters up on walls advertising socialism and things like that. But by the time I was maybe 14, I'd grown out of that, because I started to read a lot of history. And when you read history, you realise that, you know, communism is a bad idea. So I realised that was one thing. And when I was, on the other hand, I was looking at history and I realised that monarchy and tradition were actually very good. So I became very patriotic when I was about 14 or 15, which led to me joining the Navy. It's because I had this desire to serve my country. So that was coming out of someone who had been completely opposed to all of those things. And it just took a bit of thinking. But even though I'd become very traditional and very conservative in a sense, not morally, but at least in my worldview, it was more conservative. I was still not religious, so I liked the Queen and I liked the tradition of the monarchy in our country and things like that, and patriotism, but there was no religious ground for that, and therefore there was no kind of moral tradition in there. So I just went along with the flow in terms of worldly behaviour and things like that, but at least I was, you know, wasn't a communist anymore. But even then, even though I rejected the political aspect of all that, I was still very much involved in punk and such things until I became a Christian. I left home when I was 16 and I joined the Navy, and the military Navy, and it was during my time serving there that I came across Orthodoxy for the first time. And that was part of the process of my conversion, was during that. What happened was my ship was out in the Middle East during the Iraq War, and it was seeing the life of those people out there. Although these people are Muslims, but nonetheless they were very conservative, traditional people. And I noticed that their lifestyle was built around the mosque and their local communities and their families and things like that. Something we didn't have back home because we're very westernised and consumerist society in Scotland, like most of the West. And I saw that there was a richness to that life and it was very impressive. Although I was never attracted to Islam, I started to look into a different approach to life, you know, because I was an atheist, for all intents and purposes, then materialistic, and I realised there was a better way of living, and I started to investigate. So I was looking at the different religions. I started predominantly with Eastern religions, and none of them made any sense to me, really. They didn't touch me. So eventually, when I was back in the UK after this deployment to the Middle East, I started looking into Christianity. And it was through a chaplain on an army base where I was working, who was a Protestant, who introduced me to Christianity. So I'd never really given consideration to Christianity before because I wasn't interested. But now the way he described it to me was very powerful. And in fact, looking back on it, the way he introduced me to the faith was quite orthodox in a sense. He was showing me where we find Christ in the Old Testament, and I found that very convincing. So at this point I started to pray, I started to go to church. But from the very beginning, I didn't like Protestantism. I didn't like how they worshipped, I didn't like their approach to things, but it was where I was, so I was just satisfied with that. I was reading a lot of history books, and I encountered the Orthodox Church in there, and I found it quite interesting. So I was back in the Middle East again, and I began to notice that the churches in that part of the world, where the faith originally came from, they're all Orthodox. So that began to make me think that there's something more important to Orthodoxy than simply this just Eastern form of Christianity, and I was beginning to think it might be the true form. So I still wasn't quite ready yet, but eventually I went on a pilgrimage to the Holy Land with some Protestants, and we visited some of the holy sites, and it was during this 2 weeks in the Holy Land that I saw bits and pieces of Orthodox services, you know, a bit of Vespers here, some Divine Liturgy, never the full service, but we were passing through. And what I saw was beautiful. How they worshipped was really caught my attention, because the way I looked at it, you know, if Christ is the King of Kings and you come to worship him, then why are we using guitars and pop songs in church like the Protestants do? Whereas in the Orthodox Church, they seem to be really taking this seriously, that you're in the presence of the King of Kings and you come to him with the right reverence and worship that's due. So that really attracted my attention, and I decided I was going to look more into this. So when I returned home again, I began to read the teachings of the church, visited some Orthodox churches to see the full liturgy, talk to the people, and at that point I'd completely fallen in love with it. So shortly afterwards, after a little bit of soul searching and things like that, I made the decision to become Orthodox, and this is cutting a long story quite short, but I stepped into a Greek church in England, where I was based, and I simply approached the priest after service, told him I wanted to join the church, and after a little bit of confusion, because he didn't speak English, he was very happy, and then I began the process of reception into the faith. So I was baptised about 4 months later, so it was actually a very quick period, so I was baptised 4 months later, and then 18 months after my baptism, I came to the monastery. I found out about Jordanville through the Jordanville prayer book, the Miliposlav. So I was at, there was some lectures or a conference somewhere in England. Actually, it was a youth conference. And a priest from the Russian church that brought some books to sell. And I found a very nice looking prayer book. And my prayer book at that point was very thin, and that wasn't great. And I saw this one was a lot in there, and I thought, wow, this is going to be really helpful. So I got this and I enjoyed it, and then eventually I looked at where it was published, and it was Holy Trinity Monastery in Jordanville. And so I decided to look up this place, and I found out about the seminary, the monastery and everything they do here and its history, and I was very impressed with that. So it became something I knew about at that point. 7 months later, when I was getting ready to leave the Navy, my plan was to go to university to study theology and to really engage with the teachings of Christianity. Quite correctly, my confessor at the time, a Greek priest in Scotland, he told me that to go to university would not mean you could engage in a serious study of the faith, because what they teach at the universities is secularised, it's not correct. And what he said was, you should just go to seminary instead. So I questioned him and said, which seminary would you like to go to? Which seminary should I go to? And he said, you choose. So I chose Jordanville because I looked at seminaries and, you know, it was kind of a dream of mine, but I didn't expect I was ever able to go to a seminary. And I always was impressed by Jordanville because of its tradition, its integration to the monastery, the high standard of teaching here. And everything just looked very, very impressive. The liturgical life also. There was no negatives. And when he gave me the option, I chose it immediately. So he made the arrangements with my bishop, and I was sent here. So I started initially as a seminarian, as I mentioned. And I had a call to some kind of celibate life prior to arriving here. My initial plan actually was to come here, study, and then return to my own country and to serve in some missionary capacity. And I was hoping to be a celibate clergyman who would be free to serve the church in any capacity. I liked the monastic life, I liked monasteries, I visited Mount Athos, I visited Eastern Europe, I visited Essex, but I wasn't quite sure if the cenobitic life would be for me because I had a real thirst to engage in missionary work. But when I came here, and I spent my first maybe 2 months living in the dormitory with the students, but attending the services with the monks, I immediately realised that I needed the cenobitic life. This is what I wanted. So maybe in my third month of seminary, I was given permission by the abbot to move into the monastery building and became a novice. So I was a seminary and a novice almost from the beginning. And that was the case for 8 years. Until I graduated seminary. Well, it was a natural extension of something I realised very early. My life before I became Orthodox was not good. And when I came to realise that Jesus Christ was true, and he was God, and he was the true God, and I had to submit myself to him, the only way for me would be completely give myself, my life to him, and to serve him in any capacity, to the fullest. So for me it was more of an all or nothing kind of decision. I realised very, very early on that I had to give my entire life to Christ. And amongst Protestants that's kind of not very clear how to do that. But when I started to research traditional Christianity, as I was moving towards Orthodoxy, it became very clear to me that in the early days of the church, those who wanted to serve God to the fullest were celibate. They sacrificed the family life, they sacrificed social life, they sacrificed all these attachments to the world to focus on God fully, in the prayer life, in the spiritual life, and also in service to whatever capacity he called them. So this was very attractive to me. And like I said, you know, my initial calling, I felt, was to be a missionary in the world, helping spread the faith, and to be celibate and to be free from family attachments. But I realised later that the cenobitic and monastic life would be better for me. It's more structured, it's got the burial of the community, which we draw strength from, and of course the cycle of communal church services and things like that. So it was an extension of my initial impression that I had to give everything to Christ, and then realising that it was in the monastic life was more or less a natural development from discovering Orthodoxy, in which that's the pinnacle of sacrifice for Christ's sake. The first time I stepped into a church with the intention of becoming Orthodox was a Russian parish, and it was right next to where I was living at the time. But because in Great Britain the patriarchal church there has a shortage of priests, there's not enough priests for all the churches, so they only have liturgy once a month. So I liked it, I liked the community, I liked the Russian chants, it was very beautiful. But in the next town there was a Greek church which had services every single week, and for me I wanted consistency in my catechism and my liturgical life. So I went there the following week with the intention of converting, and that's where I was received into the church with the Greeks. So from the beginning I had a love for both traditions. My godmother's Greek, but my first godson was from the Russian church, from a family in the Russian church, so I had friends amongst both communities. and I equally love both traditions, as I said. And you know, when I went to the Holy Mountain several times, I was always amongst Greeks, and I very much enjoyed being amongst Greeks and in the Greek church. So when the opportunity came to come to go to seminary from my father confessor, I chose Jordanville not because it was the Russian church, but because it was such an attractive place for all those reasons I mentioned. And when I arrived here, because I'd never actually been to a Russian monastery before, it was quite different for me from what I'd experienced. But I grew to love it, and you know, I felt very much at home here. So there was no specific reason why I joined the Russian church as opposed to the Greeks or say the Serbians or anything else like that. I happened to be here, and the way I looked at it, God brought me here. He brought me to the Russian church. And obviously, since things have developed in recent years between us and the Greeks, unfortunately, but I find myself on the Russian side, and this is where I would have chosen, that I would have taken the Russian position, even if I had been in the Greek church. So God brought me here to allow me to avoid any personal struggles I might have underwent if I was still in the Greek church. So I'm very happy to be here, and for someone who has a strong desire for missionary work and things like that, I see the Russian church as the most active in that sense, and this is missionary outreach in Asia and in Europe and in North America, and I like to be part of that, and it's very encouraging that the Russian church is continuing its missionary work from before the revolution. And we here in the Russian Church abroad are very active in missionary work, so it's exciting to be part of it, and I feel very much at home amongst Russian Christians. I remember when I was being received, in the process of being received into the church, I was to choose a new name for my baptism, because my previous name was not able to be used as an Orthodox Christian. And I chose one saint, and then I changed because I discovered a new saint who I liked. And then this happened the third time, and my godmother said, "Right, you're not choosing anymore because all the saints are great, so you're just going to keep changing your mind." So eventually she chose a name for me in my baptism as opposed to me doing it myself. So I don't want to say any specific saints who had a particular influence in me that I'd like to, you know, rise above the rest. But what I will say is that there is a saint not known to many Russian people, Saint Kentigern, who's a 7th century bishop from my city in Scotland. He's an Orthodox saint, we have icons of him, and his holy relics are still in my city. Now, after the Reformation in Scotland, we destroyed all the monasteries and all the relics. By some fluke, his relics remained in his monastery, which is now a cathedral and a Protestant church. And unbeknownst to me, when I was young, we would visit his relics very, very frequently as a family, because my routine in the summer when I wasn't in school was my mother would take me and my sister to museums all over my city. We have lots of museums, and we would walk all across the city and back. And very close to where I live is the relics of St. Kentigern and his church. And we'd always stop by because it's a nice place to visit. And it was only after I became Orthodox that I realised that the holy relics of the Holy Hierarch of Kentigern were there, and I was visiting them all the time through my youth. So after I came to the faith, I started to visit his relics again with the intention of praying there. And I believe that through my encounter with the grace that is by him, that I came to the faith of St. Kentigern. So without realising it, he has had a huge effect on me. And somebody else who has had a profound effect, who's not officially canonised as saints yet, but as the three new martyrs of Optima. I find that they're very encouraging for those of us who are living the monastic life at this stage in history. I look to these men as being very normal men who came to the church later in life, went straight to the monastery, and lived as good a monastic life as they found they were able to, and they were rewarded by God with martyrdom at the end of it. So I read their life, and I'm not ashamed to admit that I was reduced to tears because of the simplicity and beauty of it, and that's what I take encouragement from. That, you know, even nowadays, with all the baggage that we have from our life before Orthodoxy, that we can come into the monastery and God sees our struggles and he rewards them according to his grace and kindness towards us. So those two have an effect. But all the saints are great, of course. At first, they felt it was very peculiar and very strange. My mother's come to terms with it now. She's visited the monastery a couple of times, and she likes the community here. She is still not a believer, but she has at least a positive opinion. But not one person in my family is a believer. Catholic, Protestant, nothing. None of them go to church. So I had never met a Christian in my life until I decided to become a Christian myself. Yeah, at least from my own background. I mean, I met, say, foreigners who were Christians, but never amongst my own community. I'd never met someone who went to church. So, in Scotland, we closed our churches, not all of them, but a lot of them, and we stopped going to church without the government telling us. Whereas in the Soviet Union, they had to destroy the churches to stop people from going. So, the problems we have in my country, we did ourselves. You know, we just gave up in the faith. We gave up in Christianity. So, you meet very few people who are actually religious. So there's very few people that talk about these things. But when you start becoming a Christian in Scotland or in the UK, it's a part of it's another world opens up, because there's all these people who you'd never meet before anywhere else. And it's like an underground thing. It's like a subculture, because there's so few. But it's not because of persecutions, it's just because apathy, which is much worse. Much worse. So, but thankfully there's a real need in people's souls now in Scotland for the faith. And now that Orthodoxy is growing in Scotland, many people have been attracted. So that's a positive side. But there's very little to work with in terms of faith. From everybody's responsibilities are different, and I thank God that even though I live here at the monastery and I very seldom leave to go anywhere, that he's been able to, as you can say, answer my desire to become a missionary even here, because now we have so many people all over the world who become interested in joining the Orthodox Church, whether it's in North America, Western Europe, Asia, Africa, and for some reason they find our monastery, whether it's online or through the prayer book or something, and they contact us and ask questions. And my job here, or one of my jobs here for the past few years, has been to contact these people, to send them books, to send them information about local priests or parishes that they can visit, to answer their questions about the faith. So in a sense, I can be a missionary without even leaving the monastery. And we have many, many people who also come to visit here in person, haven't heard about the faith, and they live nearby, or for some reason they will travel here from another part of America to visit the monastery, and I will be given the opportunity to talk to these people and help explain things, help them take the first steps into the church, and this is happening more and more frequently these days, which is a big blessing for us. So I feel very grateful towards God for allowing me to carry out this work. Consistency is the most important thing. I mean, we have a cycle: church services, feast days, obediences, or prayer rule. And I find that the most important thing for monks is just to be consistent. And you know, and obviously humility is important. You know, we realize that we are at a point in history where we don't have the same spiritual strength or physical strength as the ancients. So we need to know our limitations. And not try and go ahead of ourselves. And that's one thing I've learned here at Jordanville, is we have a very down-to-earth approach to spiritual life and asceticism, things like that. So we're expected to carry out our obediences, carry out what's expected of us, but no one's permitted to be carried away and to think they can become great ascetics. You know, but by simply keeping the commandments and being consistent in our lives, that's the path to, you know, genuine monastic life nowadays. And that's why I tell the students here also, just be consistent, and God will reward that consistency, you know, even if you don't, you know, you trip up and fall sometimes. We just need to keep trying and be persistent. You know, we don't have the peace and quiet sometimes, or sometimes we don't get enough rest, or we get distracted by the people, but this is part of our labels. You know, we have to sacrifice our, you know, our comfort sometimes for the sake of others. People come to us from the world, but they don't have the blessings that we have. We have the services here, we have all the holy things here, and they don't have that in the world. So when they come here, we need to be available to them to facilitate their encounter with God through the church services and through the holy people who have been here in the past. So we can't begrudge that. So we need to give a little and we'll receive a lot in return. So we can't become annoyed or bitter about anything. Well, in a sense, the Orthodox Church doesn't have a future because it's in eternity with Christ. It will never cease to exist because we're the body of Christ. But in a temporal sense, we have a future, of course. I used to think Christianity was finished when I was an atheist, but I was ignorant. And now I've stepped into the light and I am a Christian. I can see that the faith is continually growing. So it's easy for people who are in one part of the world to think that the faith might be dying out because the people around them are not interested. But in other parts of the world, there's people flocking to the Orthodox churches to receive the faith. So we can't universalise our own perspectives and our own experiences. We have to look at the broader scope of the church and its life and history. There's always been times where parts of the church has declined in certain parts of the world and it's been growing in others. So we just have to maybe realise that where we are at might be a weak stage in the church, but elsewhere it's grown. And you know, one of the problems now that people do lose their faith very easily is the high level of propaganda that's in the media and in schools and educational institutions, which is materialistic, it's atheistic, as opposed to Christianity. And one thing people need to realise is that there is Christian responses to all of those things, and we just need to go and find them. And we'll find that the church has an answer to all of these difficult questions. So you do find a lot of people leave the church because of some moral dilemma or something to the science or something like that. But you will find that in the fathers and in modern holy people, all these things have been addressed, have been dealt with, and we have very sufficient answers, which are not just for spiritual nourishing, but intellectually robust. And if people arm themselves with that, if they read spiritual books, if they read the writings of holy elders and similar literature, they'll find themselves protected against these temptations. You know, we just need to engage more in the life of the church. And when we become more aware of what is available to us and what's in the church, you know, the temptations of the world, the distractions, they won't have as much of a pull effect to take people away from the faith. So we just need to engage. And it takes a lot of work from us. But, you know, Christian life is not passive, it's active. We need to really engage if we want our faith to grow. Especially in times like this, which are very, very hard for those who have the faith. But you know, as we see from the new Mars Confessor of Russia, if you can live in a society which is completely opposed to the faith, if you just hold on to the Christian life, you'll get through everything, and you know, God will reward you with martyrdom and sanctity. So we can see that, we can take encouragement from them. Да, я учился русский язык 3 года в семинарии, но я очень плохо говорю на русском. У меня очень много практика на Кровнославянском церкви, служение, ну, как диакон, я служу на Кровнославянском, и я очень люблю служить на Кровнославянском. Литургический язык, это божественный язык, но для разговаривания на русском я очень плохо, это очень трудно, но как ты слушаешь, подожди, очень трудно. Well, there's two sides to this. The first thing then to say is, after I became Orthodox, I became more Scottish, because for us to be Scottish is to be in communion with the Scottish saints, and my country is no longer in communion with the saints. We abandoned the faith, but the saints who built my country, the saints who created the Scottish people, our culture, they're Orthodox saints. St. Columba, St. Kentigern, St. Ninian, St. Serf, many others. I'm in the same church that they're in now. So I have a great love for Scotland and its ancient culture and its ancient history. So I would say I'm more Scottish now because I'm part of the ancient Scottish church. But the Russian culture I love. And because I can see many similarities between the Scottish and the Russian people, both of us are very down to earth, a little bit rough around the edges, and I like it. You know, there's no pretenses, if you will, with the Russian and the Scottish people. We're very upfront and very honest, and I like the Russian spirit. You know, it's willing to go through hard times and always see something good at the end, and that's driven by is the Orthodox basis for Russian culture. So Russian culture has a richness, and I'm very happy that I'm part of the greater Russian community, because they appreciate their culture, they appreciate their traditions, their language, their history, their great people, their music, their food, their ethnic dress. Whereas in my country, that is slowly being dismantled and we're losing it. So we've lost an appreciation for that. So I see amongst the Russians something I'd like my own people to have. So their love for everything which is part of their culture and which is closely integrated with the faith is encouraging for me, and I like part of it. So I can say I have foot in both camps. I'm obviously first and foremost Scottish, but I'm an adopted son of the Russian church, and I'm happy to be part of that. So I don't see any conflict at all. I don't ever feel left out. And I appreciate being part of something which is very cohesive and very strong. And you can tell that the Russian traditions and the Russian cultures are not going to go away like they have in the West, which has lost almost everything. It's something which is fueled by a great love that comes from the Russian people. So it's very encouraging. And yes, I don't ever feel left out or alienated by it. Mm-hmm. It's just a fact of the life we have here, and it's a good one. Well, I've been blessed by seeing many things. We have many mushroom and icons that have come here. I've been edified by stories of people from the community here, pilgrims, of miracles that have happened in their life. So one of the things that happened to me when I was heading towards Orthodoxy, or rather when I was investigating Christianity, I was in Malta on holiday with my uncle. And even though I was not a Christian, I like to explore old churches and have a look at the art and architecture. And I was in an old Roman Catholic church in Malta, which has many, many, many churches. And I saw a woman praying in the far corner of the room. And something touched me at that point. I saw that woman praying, and I realised that this was something I needed in my life. So this was one of the kind of gentle pushes towards the faith that I needed to really look at Christianity again. But I never really got to see what was that woman was praying at. Now, after I became Orthodox, and part of leaving Protestantism behind and becoming Orthodox was discovering veneration of the Mother of God. And I saw the important role that she plays within the church and in our lives as Christians, and I grew to, like we all do, to love her and have a special love for her as the Mother of God. And I stopped in Malta with my ship on my way back from the Middle East on my last ever tour of duty with the Navy. And I decided to go back to that church to see what that woman was praying at. Maybe she was praying at some shrine to a saint. I was interested to see, because that moment had such a profound effect on me. And I went to the church, and I was really hoping it wasn't going to be some statue of a Catholic saint, because it, you know, would raise some questions. But I completely unexpectedly went into this church, and I went to the exact place where that woman was praying, and right above the altar, there was no statue, there was a beautiful medieval Greek icon of the Theotokos, the milk giver. I'm not ashamed to admit, I started crying because I'd developed such a love for the Mother of God that to see that she was the one whose prayers had drawn me into the faith. So it was a very powerful moment. So I had my prayer book with me, and I read an Akathist to the Mother of God in front of this icon, with tears, and tourists must have thought I was insane. But that was a very big encouragement for me. It showed me that the Mother of God is helping her son seek out the lost and bring them back to the church. So whenever I was able to visit the Holy Mountain, I went there twice after that occasion. The beautiful icons of the Mother of God that are there, I was able to give thanks, and to serve her on in her garden, as it were. So, which led to another interesting occasion when I was out, my last ever visit to Mount Athos. We were working at Kudlomusio Monastery for 10 days to prepare them for their Prestolny Praznik, and I had injured my foot and my toe had gone infected, and it was very bad, very dirty. I could barely walk, and I had about a week's worth of work left to do. I couldn't stand my leg. So one day I went to the icon of the Theotokos, which is in the church, and I said, I prayed to the Mother of God and said, I've come to your garden to help the monks here and to help cultivate your land. Help me to work for you. And after we left church that morning, we went to get some rest at the in the guest house. I woke up to find my foot was completely healed. So again, another sign from the Mother of God that she honours those who honour her. And coming from being a Protestant who, has no interest in the Mother of God, to someone who has a great love for her, it shows that if we treat her as a mother, she will receive us and honour us. So these are big encouragements. And then all the mercy and icons of the Theotokos that have visited Jordanville, it just reinforced that time and time again, that if we go to the Theotokos, she'll help us in everything. And she's there to assist the Christians. That's her vocation from her son, is to help us. I look at it this way. I'm here because God willed it to be. Everything happens according to his permission. He permitted me to be here, and it was my decision to be here, but God has blessed it. And since being here, my life hasn't been without temptations and struggles and trials, but this is part of being a Christian and being a part of a monk especially. But I see that here in Jordanville, in the Russian church, is where I can find salvation, and I have absolutely no regrets whatsoever about my place in life. I feel that I can draw closer to God here, I can serve God, and like I said, I can be saved here, which is most important. So 100% no regrets. I love being here and I love being part of this church.